convince you today that yes, you have a testimony. If you call yourself a son or a daughter or a child of the Most High God, you have a testimony worth saying today. You have a story to tell. And I can promise you right now, if there is breath in your lungs, God wants to use you. He's not done with you yet, and the best is still to come. We're going to declare that today. I just want you to join in with us. It goes like this.
If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Come on.
Yeah. much power in your name, God. There's so much power in the name of Jesus. Power to save, the power to heal, the power to redeem. God, we just want to be where you are today, Lord. We just surrender to you today, God. There's nowhere else I'd rather be. All than right here in your presence. No, there is no place I'd rather be, God, than right here in your presence, right here in your presence, right here, God, and I can't get enough. I can't get enough of your amazing love. No, I can't get enough, and I can't walk away. No, I can't. Get enough. are so holy. You are so holy.
Love you today. We thank you for this time of worship. God, we thank you that nothing in this world or the world to come can separate us from your love. Father, in a world that is changing, a world that is shifting sand, Father, you are constant and you are well able and your love never fails. It never changes. And so today, Lord, we thank you for that. We rest today. We choose to abide in your ever-present love for each of us. Lord, I pray over your people today. I pray over each person that's tuning in right there in their homes or wherever they're at. Father, you would speak to them today. This would not be an idle time for them in their worship, but this would be a time, Lord, that your spirit would speak to them. And we thank you today that our ears can hear, our spirits can perceive. God, give us your vision, give us your perspective. Father, we thank you for this time. Lord, I pray that it is a refocus during this worship time. Lord, again, with so much going on, we choose to set our eyes on the things above, the things of heaven, the things that are eternal. Father, we choose to pray over our city today, Denver, Colorado. We thank you for an awesome city. Lord, we pray over the people, our neighbors. Lord, we lift up our neighbors right around us. We pray over our coworkers today. Father, we thank you. You give us favor wherever we go. We thank you that the light of Christ goes wherever we go. Father, your love shines through us in every situation. Father, we give you this service. We thank you for the opportunity to worship together. Father, bless our time, bless the word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Praise God. Thank you for being with us today. Here we are at Legacy Chapel. I'm so glad that you chose to tune in with us today in worship. We've got an awesome word for you today. Man, what a fantastic worship. Right now, I've got a couple of announcements for you that I want to give you today. I want to tell you this morning in your email, Legacy Chapel, you received, of course, the links and information for today's service, but also a survey. This is very, very important. As many of you are hearing around Denver, and our governor got on just a day or so ago and announced houses of worship, and of course, our president before him did that, announcing that houses of worship are essential. So here's what we've been doing as a leadership team. We have been planning ahead of even that announcement what it would be like for us to come back together in worship. And so we've got a number of things already in the works. You may, I don't know if you can tell today, but I think there's a few things different on the screen for you. We're working on some stuff from behind the scenes that will help our efforts in making sure that we continue with online worship. But here's the deal. The survey that's in your email, we need you to go there, click on that survey and fill out. It's very short, very brief, but it helps us as a church, myself, the leadership team, the staff, and our planning for worship in the days ahead. So what we've announced, and we're sticking to it, today we're worshiping online. Next week on May 31st, we're worshiping online. And then June the 7th is the time that we will start having live services together. But there's a few things that are different. Now, here's the deal. You need to fill out that survey for us so that we know how many people are coming. And then we're already planning some changes, things that we feel like are necessary for who we are and our heritage of church, but also recognizing some of the things that our government is asking us to do. And so here's the deal. You're going to fill out the survey. It's going to help give us feedback. And then in the next few days, this week, I'm going to send out a specific different video than a Sunday morning, because I can't cover everything that I would say on a Sunday morning about coming back to worship. We're going to be sending out another video with instructions and things you can expect as you come back for worship, how we're going to facilitate that, what's going to happen, and so that you'll know. And then we want to know and hear from you. It's really important that we know what you're planning to do, whether you're planning to come back or ready to stay online. And here's what we're planning. I'll tell you in big items. We are planning to do a live service on Sunday morning, June the 7th, but we're also, for the foreseeable future, going to continue with online worship. So for those of you, be rest assured, you can still tune in and worship with us online. We're going to continue that, maintain the same level of quality. That's the part of what we've been working on for you to worship online, but then also June the 7th, have people come back and worship. So it's really important that you take the survey, fill that out, and then on June the 7th is the first Sunday that we'll be back together live, and so be on the lookout for that video for me. Now, one of the other cool things that we're going to be doing for our kids, Friday night, June the 5th, we're going to have a movie night here on site at Legacy Chapel. It'll be outdoors. There'll be spaces that you'll sit in, appropriately distanced out, but we have an outdoor movie screen, and we're going to run a movie for the kids. You're going to bring your own snacks, so we're not going to be serving any snacks. You'll bring your own snacks, your own picnic, and that'll be at 8 p.m. on June the 5th, so that'll be a lot of fun. Just a quick reminder that we will continue with the prayer boxes, or that we have prayer boxes still available. So if you'd like to do one of those, they're really cool, a box with some sweet stuff in there, some swag from Legacy Chapel for you and your family, but also the opportunity to go out and pray for a very specific area of the city, specific industries, specific ministries, and we want to stay engaged, right, Legacy Chapel? We want to stay engaged with our city and stay hooked up, praying over all that's going on, and so through these prayer boxes, you can do that. If you'd like to get one of those, you can, as part of your giving today in the drop-down menu, when you do your online giving, or you can text to give, there's a drop-down menu. Text to give, text the amount to 84321. Text the number 84321. So you'll text the amount of your gift and then to that number 84321. In the drop-down menu, you'll pick Outreach Ministry. They're $100 for those boxes. We'd love for families to do that together, even growth groups if you'd like to do that. You can certainly get out and go pray. All right, so today on the live chat, there's the link for giving. There's the link for the sermon notes. I want to remind all of you with your friends and loved ones around, Legacy Chapel is ready to help and serve you. So if you would email, you know someone that needs help, email help@legacychapel.org, and we will respond. Prayer requests are at prayer@legacychapel.org. And then at the end of service today, we have the live prayer room in the Zoom that you can join. All right, so today, no breaks. We're just going to go right into the message today. It's my plan that today is the end of this series entitled Home, and next week on May 31st, I'm going to start a new series. Pentecost Sunday is that day, but I'll be bringing you a new series on that day, and so today is part 7 of Home, and the title is Resurrection Promise, Resurrection Promise. So throughout our series entitled Home, we've had the opportunity to look at scriptures in the Bible that have this setting of a home, and then we've been very pointed coming out of Easter, out of Resurrection Sunday, very pointed about understanding the power of the resurrection, and looking deeply into the things that Christ has brought us through the death, burial, and resurrection and the power that comes from that resurrection. And so we'll be sticking with that today. Our text will be in Acts chapter 10. If you've got your old school Bible or if you've got your device and you want to look that up real quick, Acts chapter 10 is where we're going to be today. But I want to remind you some things I told you last week on Pentecost, and that is Pentecost is a Greek word that literally means 50 or 50th. 50th, which means 50 days from Easter, 50 days from the resurrection. That's when we see in Acts chapter 1 and Acts chapter 2 that I taught last week that Jesus said, and we'll read an excerpt here in a moment, Jesus said, I want you to go and wait for the Holy Spirit that will come. And of course, Acts gives us a vivid picture of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That was the 50th day. And the Bible says it was when the fullness of Pentecost had come. When the fullness of Pentecost had come, then the Holy Spirit was poured out. Now it's significant in a timetable for us to recognize that as Christians, but it's more than just a holiday to celebrate. I want you to know that. That's what I said last week. I want you to know that Pentecost is a holiday for us to celebrate. But more than that, listen to me, more than that is it was the birth of the New Testament church. It was the birth of the New Covenant church. Our opportunity to live in the fullness of who we are in Christ Jesus, our ability to do that is not in our own strength. Our ability to do that is with the power of the Holy Spirit. And so there's a direct connect here between what the Holy Spirit has done and our believing and our faith in Him today, that as we live out the promises of God and we look at resurrection promise, I want you to hear very clearly, we cannot do that without the Holy Spirit. And so Pentecost, next Sunday, is the date on the calendar, the natural calendar, that we see the 50th day out from Easter. And so we celebrate on May 31st, Pentecost. So today we're going to look again at the resurrection. We're going to look specifically in Acts as we study a little bit more about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit and what it means for us today. And of course, if you know much about your Bible, you know resurrection promise. I'm talking about Jesus's words. He called the Holy Spirit the promise. So the resurrection promise that we have is in fact the Holy Spirit. Now here's what's key about Jesus calling it the promise is that the Holy Spirit came to the church, like I just said, and that as he came to the church, Jesus left. Now here in John chapter 16 and 7, it's your first verse there in your notes. It says, Jesus's words, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I go away, the helper, notice that, the helper will come to you, and if I depart, I will send him to you. So this was literally, as Jesus said, the Holy Spirit is coming, go and wait for him. And he said, I have to go away so the Holy Spirit will come. He was foretelling the end of a season where he was on earth in the physical form and the beginning of his anointing staying on the earth, which is the Holy Spirit, and then infilling the lives of the people that would receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So it's really important that we understand Jesus' instructions that there is more to the life that we know in Christ Jesus, and that is the Holy Spirit. So Jesus said these words, and we've quoted this scripture a lot here at Legacy Chapel, John 10 and 10, Jesus' words, the thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Now here's what I want to say about this. Jesus said, I've come to give you life, which we know that's the resurrection power and life that comes through the cross, that he became the bridge between mankind and God Almighty, that our faith in Jesus Christ allows us to know that he hears us when we pray. And the fact that he hears us when we pray, we know that our faith can be placed in him and that eternal life is secure. And when he said, I've come to bring you life, he's talking about eternal life. But then he doesn't stop there, which is where most people stop. He continues and says, I've not just brought you life, I've brought it to you. I desire to bring it to you more abundantly. So we could summarize it this way, and it would be doctrinally accurate and theologically accurate, and that is this, that when we fall in love with the person of Jesus, we receive eternal life. And when we fall in love with the principles of Jesus, that's the ministry of Jesus, that's actually the ministry of the Holy Spirit, we receive the abundant life. So when we fall in love with the person of Jesus, we receive eternal life. That's Jesus as Lord and Savior. When we fall in love with the ministry or the principles of Jesus, we receive the abundant life that he's brought for us. Now, wasn't that good? Now, last week we read Acts chapter 1 and verse 4 and 5, and this is Jesus again saying to the disciples, he said, "And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise." There it is. He calls the Holy Spirit the promise. "But wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, 'You have heard from me, for truly John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now.'" So Jesus knew that the disciples needed to wait. Now they were filled up with many of the teachings and the truths and the gospel message that they needed to go and make disciples, because that was the Great Commission. What is it that Jesus wants us to do? He wants us to go out and make disciples. And he said, "Fellas, hold on. Before you just run out and go, I need you to go, and I need you to go to Jerusalem and wait on the Holy Spirit." And what I want you to see there is that there is a maturing time. There, just like a mother who becomes pregnant and is going to have a baby, there's a gestation period. There's the opportunity for that baby to grow, for that promise to grow, for those truths to grow. And so Jesus knew that the disciples needed the empowerment that was from on high, that dunamis that we've talked about, into the believer so that they were fully equipped to go do what they were called to do. And so that we must know today, if Jesus said, let me summarize, if Jesus said, it's important that I go away, it's better, in fact, that I go away and that the Holy Spirit come. And then he says in John 10 and 10, I've not come to bring you, or the Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come to give you life and life more abundantly. He's saying that when he goes away and the Holy Spirit comes, life that is abundant is yours when we receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And this is a critical thing for our lives and for believers. So as we look at the resurrection promise today, we're going to look in Acts chapter 10, and we're going to focus on abundant living. And there's two instances here. There's two characters that we're going to draw out in this story today that I want you to see the resurrection promise for both of them that you can see for your life that we can learn from. All right, you ready? Acts chapter 10 and verse 1, it says this. "And there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of what was called the Italian regiment." Verse 2, "a devout man and one who feared God with all of his household." You see that? He was a devout man and one who feared God with all of his household, "who gave alms generously to the people and prayed to God always." This is a very distinct and very clear description of where the centurion man Cornelius was at. He was devout in his faith in God. Do you see that? It's important that you capture that. And then it says, "about the ninth hour of the day, he saw clearly in a vision." What do we learn from that? We know that there was two times of day in the Jewish faith that they prayed. Now, this was a Gentile man. This was a man of the Italian regiment, a centurion man. But he was a Gentile man who fell in love with God, that he was following the practices. Hear me now. He was following the practices and the routines of the Jewish faith, but he was a Gentile man. And it gives us clarity that he was faithful to that because he was praying in the ninth hour when all of the Jews prayed. There was two times a day, and one of them was the ninth hour. And the ninth hour of the day, he clearly in a vision, an angel of the Lord coming and saying to him, "Cornelius." And when he observed him, he was afraid and said, "What is it, Lord?" And so he said to him, "Your prayers and your alms have come up for a memorial before God." More there, indicating his Jewish beliefs, that it was a memorial before God. Verse 5, "and now send men to Joppa and send for Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodging with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea, and he will tell you what you must do." That's very important. Verse 7, "and when the angel who spoke to him had departed, Cornelius called two of his household servants and a devout soldier from among those who waited on him continually." So he was a man of authority. Verse 8, "so when he had explained all these things to him, he sent them to Joppa." So what is my resurrection promise? Or what is it that we get from the resurrection? I'll tell you very clearly, it's the Holy Spirit. But today, the promise for you and I, as we receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit, and we understand the importance of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit for our lives, I want you to see this. Number one, what do we receive as the resurrection promise? Number one, we receive spiritual revelation. We receive spiritual revelation. Now, as I read, Cornelius was a devout man. And he feared God, right? And he believed I believe that he was crying out to God in his faithfulness, and God heard him. We know because the scripture said, your alms and your prayers have come up before the Lord as a memorial. So the Lord answered him with an angel. And as the Lord answered him with an angel, he knew that Cornelius needed a word. Cornelius needed something to take him to the next level. So what did he do? He put Peter on assignment. He put Simon Peter, which we just read, on assignment to come to Cornelius, saying, Cornelius, you're a man of authority. I want you to go get Simon Peter. He's staying at this exact house. Isn't that amazing? He's staying at this exact, in this city, in this house, in this man's house. I want you to go get him, and he's got a word that he wants to share with you. Now, this is an important passage of scripture because we know that faith comes by hearing the word. And many times when we understand certain things, follow me here, when we understand or have knowledge of certain things, what unlocks that knowledge or what unlocks that understanding is revelation. Church, today, I believe that we don't need more information. I believe that we need more revelation. Amen? We need more revelation of God's word. And so I believe that Cornelius, of course, God's teaching us through the scriptures here by his Holy Spirit, Cornelius had a lot of knowledge. He had a lot of understanding of what Moses taught the Jews in the law, but God wanted to unlock him out of religion. That's really what we're talking about today. And of course, Peter had experienced the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 1 and 2. He was there. He preached the first sermon after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So he told Cornelius, you need to get Peter, and he needs to come to your house, and he's got a word for you. And Cornelius was a faithful man. He was a devout man, and he did exactly what the angel told him to do. I wonder how many of us would do exactly what the angel told us to do. But he did. He followed it. And of course, today, it's the empowerment. The church of Jesus Christ receives the empowerment through the Holy Spirit. And so today, we need to understand that we need more revelation, not just more information. Now, most of America, and really most of Denver is one of the highest per capita upper level graduate degrees in all of America, is right here in the Denver metro area. We have some really, really smart people. And I applaud that. I celebrate that. In fact, I like being around intelligent people more than I like being around dumb people. So I celebrate intellectual people. But your intellectualism and what you can have mental assent to does not bring you spiritual revelation. Watch this scripture now. Paul taught this in 1 Corinthians 2 and 14. It says this, but the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. Isn't that interesting? Nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. They are spiritually discerned. There's a big difference between the natural receiving natural understanding and the Spirit receiving spiritual understanding. So what we receive from the resurrection is, of course, the resurrection promise, and what we receive is spiritual or supernatural revelation. We need, church, we need spiritual discernment. One of the things that we get from the ministry of the Holy Spirit is the opportunity to discern spiritually about certain things. I have often said it this way, and I counsel people around my life or in my friendships when they ask me certain things, and I tell them like this. I say, listen, in my life, you know, I value the data points. I value the information, right? I believe that you should be competent in a certain area. If you're diving into investments or you're diving into something new, you need to gain knowledge and gain understanding. Come on, smart people, you should be saying amen right now, right? You dive in to know what those things are. But once you have that competency, from a Christian standpoint, a New Testament church, a New Testament Christian standpoint, understanding the importance of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, I say it this way. I don't want just a good thing. I want a God thing. I don't want just a good deal. I want a God deal. You see the difference? That once I've collected all of the information and once I have it all, I put all of that before the feet of Jesus and I say, Lord, is this what you would have me do? Now, for Abigail and I, for Abby and I in our marriage, there's definitely come a place in our life where early on, where we submitted to the peace of God. You guys have heard me talk about that. We've submitted to the peace. If we don't have peace, she doesn't have peace. And let's say I have peace, then we don't move. If one of us doesn't have peace, we don't move. We're looking for a God thing, not just a good thing. Now, let me give you an example of this in the church here many years ago. So we're getting ready to come up on 9 years is our anniversary pretty soon. The church's anniversary, 9 years in September. And several years ago, we had another building that came up for sale. And we were back in the elementary gymnasium looking for a church building. And this other building came up. And I'll tell you, by all outward appearances, it looked like it was a good, you know, it was the right thing. And when we put, you know, pen to paper, it was a good deal. And as we looked at it, and we actually had a prayer meeting with the church, and we went over, and Abby and I saw it a bunch, and I flew in the board, which you guys know our board is half of them live out of state, half of them live in state. We flew them all in, and we went and toured it. We prayed over it. I had the backing of the board. Listen to this. I had the backing of the board. I had, for the most part, I think I had people backing me in the church saying, yes, Pastor, let's go for this. And as Abby and I put all of that information, hear me now, as Abby and I put all that information before the Lord and at the feet of Jesus, we said, Lord, what is it that you want us to do? Now, on the surface, it looked like a really, really good deal. This was a next good step. And I'll tell you, when Abby and I went to pray, as pastors of this church, we went to pray and the Holy Spirit said to us both very clearly, I like it when he speaks to us the same thing on the same timing. That's always helpful in your marriage, by the way. It really helped me. When he said to us, no, it was no. Lord, is this what you want us to do? And the Holy Spirit said, no. Abby had a check in her spirit. I had a check in my spirit. And the Holy Spirit said, no. And I had to call the realtor up and I had to call all of the people up and say, you know what? The Lord, I had to stand in front of the congregation. I had to call the board, right? I had to tell them all that this is not what the Lord would have us to do. We're not supposed to do this deal. And I'll tell you, we got a little bit of flack back from that, from the people that were associated in that transaction. They didn't like it. But listen, I am resolute that I want a God thing, not a good thing. And so what we receive from the ministry of the Holy Spirit, and you're gonna see here from Cornelius as he goes and gets Peter, is that we just don't need more information, we need revelation. We need revelation knowledge. We need insight and wisdom. We need the Holy Spirit to speak to us about the day and hour in which we live and all of these things that are going on. And of course, we lead the church just the way that I just described. We gather all the information. We try to do as much research as we can possibly do on whatever it might be, big or small. And then we pray about it, Lord, what is it that we should do? So we need revelation in our lives, not just information. I appreciate and I have a value for information, but I have a higher value for revelation. Now watch this. In Acts chapter 10 and verse 19, as we continue reading in our text today, it says this, while Peter thought about the vision, the Spirit said to him, behold, three men are seeking you. Now stop for a moment. As Cornelius was calling for Peter, as you break away and you pull back in the scriptures, it moves on. And Peter, at the exact same time, in the ninth hour of the day, we don't have time to read it all, but in the ninth hour of the day, Peter was praying and Peter had a vision. And the vision that he had spoke to something that he needed in his life. And as we read here in verse 19 of Acts chapter 10, the Spirit said, behold, there's three men that are coming for you. Verse 20, arise therefore, go down with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. And I'll tell you that I believe, of course, we find out at the end, Peter knew that these were Gentiles that were coming to get him. Peter had a religious wall that was built up to anybody outside of the Jewish faith. And of course, God was working to break that down within Peter, because if he was gonna go to be a witness to all the world, he had to get over that religiosity that was in his life. So God sent Gentiles, gave him instruction to not doubt them, that God had sent them, but to go with them. So now we've got two people. Do you see this in the scripture? We've got two people, Cornelius and Peter, that are on a collision course with one another, both needing something different, but God bringing them together. Peter needed to have spiritual discernment for his life too. If you remember back in Matthew chapter 16, Jesus asked these words to Peter, who do people say that I am? And Peter answered him, Simon Peter said, you are the Christ, verse 16 in Matthew 16, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood. Notice that. For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. What was he saying? It's not just information that you've received. You have revelation on this particular subject. Peter, you are rightly discerning that I am the Christ. This for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven, verse 18, and I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades or the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Of course, you know, Jesus declared these words in advance of greater maturity in Peter's life. And in the natural, you know, Peter wasn't gonna be able to stand against the gates of hell. In fact, he fell in his confidence and his support of Jesus. We know he denied Jesus three times. And so how was God going to make sure that Peter would be the cornerstone of the church by which Jesus would build the church and the gates of hell would not prevail against it? I'll submit to you, summarizing a whole lot of scripture and very on point, it's through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. It's recognizing that I can't do it in my own strength. I can't go and do what God's called me to do. Frankly, I couldn't stand here today in this pulpit and preach to you without the ministry of the Holy Spirit inspiring me and bringing me revelation and bringing me strength and clarity of mind and thought to deliver sermons and messages to you guys. It's by the ministry of the Holy Spirit. I want to advocate in the same way that Peter received it as a regular fisherman, that you can receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the same way and allow the Holy Spirit to empower you with spiritual, supernatural revelation for your life, like he's done for me and like he's done for so many other Christians across the world. I want you to see the importance of what we receive from the resurrection. The resurrection promise that we receive is spiritual revelation. You with me? This is powerful stuff. This is good stuff. So now as we continue on in Acts 10, verse 24, it says this, the following day they entered Caesarea. So Peter went with them. He went with the three, and he's meeting up now with Cornelius. And the following day they entered Caesarea. Now Cornelius was waiting for them and had called together his relatives and close friends. As Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him, fell down at his feet, and worshiped him. Verse 26, but Peter lifted him up, saying, stand up. I myself am also a man. So he didn't want him to be praising him because Peter knew the word that was on the inside of him. Listen, this is not about me. And of course, Cornelius was demonstrating some of that religious mindset and some of that law that was in him. And I believe that Peter was brightly perceiving and discerning. Look, this is not about that. This is a new thing. I'm not bringing you information. I'm bringing you revelation. And so he fell down at his feet and said, I'm just a man too, verse 27. And as he talked with him, he went in and found many who had come together. And he said to them, so this was in the setting of Cornelius's home, which is very on point to our series entitled Home. Here we are again in a home. Let's see where we at, verse 27. And when he had asked him, he went in and found many who had come together, verse 28. And then he said to them, you know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man, this is Peter talking, to keep company with or to go with one from another nation, but God has shown me, how interesting, right? Revelation, not information, but God has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Therefore, I came without objection. So as soon as I was sent for, I asked then, for what reason have you sent me? And of course, Cornelius goes on and gives him the same. If you read the passage there, he goes on and gives him the same recount of the story of what happened to him. And of course, their stories harmonize that, wow, this thing happened at the exact same hour of the day. You were praying, I was praying. God told me to go get you. You came here. You know, you're a Jew and I'm a Gentile, Cornelius said. I mean, God was doing something very unique at that time that was bringing revelation to both of them that they both needed. Now, Here's what's awesome. They both needed revelation. And of course, God was doing one thing for Cornelius and doing one thing for Peter. And it was both revelation for both of them. And of course, this leads us into point number two. Before we go to point number two, I want to ask you this question. What is it, church? What is it in your personal life right now, in your walk with the Lord, that he is revealing to you? Now, let me be very pastoral for just a moment. In the middle of this season, where many of you you're spending the large majority of your time in your home, the Holy Spirit is still speaking. The anointing of Jesus Christ that breaks yokes and lifts burdens is speaking by the voice of the Holy Spirit to your people. I believe that he's even speaking right now, and he's fortifying some stuff in your heart that you needed to hear. And I want to encourage you right now to be listening, even in this season where so much has changed. I believe the voice of God is speaking loud and clear like never before. And you need to be locked into what is that revelation? What is God saying to me? And I'll tell you, every day, God is speaking. If you're crying out and you're like Cornelius, who maybe you're devout in your routine as he was in his religious mindset, God is speaking and your ears need to be tuned in. And when you receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit, that's how you perceive, just like Peter did. Peter perceived that Jesus was the Christ. Peter perceived by the Spirit that was speaking to him, you need to get up and go with the three men that are downstairs that have come with you. We know that they're Gentiles, the Holy Spirit said to him. I know that they're Gentiles, but I want you to go with them. So it's revelation that is brought to their lives. Now, number two today, what is the resurrection promise for me? Of course, it comes by the Holy Spirit. But number two, the revelation that both of these guys needed, Cornelius and Peter, number two is to remove damaging or limiting beliefs. What does the Holy Spirit do for you and me? What came out of the resurrection and Jesus coming out of the grave and then Jesus saying, it's better for me to leave and the Holy Spirit to come? What was that? Well, it was the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, one of the benefits of the Holy Spirit being active in your life is that Holy Spirit will remove damaging and limiting beliefs in your life. There's oftentimes, you know, we carry stuff from one generation to the next and then pass it down to the next generation that are belief systems and paradigms that are not actually in the Bible. They're not actually a part of the truth of what Jesus came to bring, the finished work of the cross and the ministry of the Holy Spirit. They're not in there, but we've passed them down. And this is exactly what I believe that God wanted for Cornelius. He wanted to break him out of his religiosity. God wanted to break Peter out of his mindset that he could only minister to Jews. That was from the law. This is the new covenant. The Holy Spirit had been poured out. It's a new day. It's a new time of ministry. And this is what the Holy Spirit will bring. The Holy Spirit will remove, listen, church, will remove damaging and limiting beliefs. God was helping Cornelius with Peter, and he was helping Peter with Cornelius. He was doing both at the exact same time. I'm thankful, honestly, that Cornelius was so hungry because God can use that. And I'm thankful that Peter, even both of them had things that were wrong that they were believing, but their hearts were turned towards God. God could use them. He could mold them in the middle of that. Now, many of us, let me give you this example, and this example I'm about to give you about damaging and limiting beliefs, it's fairly light in its example. And I got this from my father who pastored 30 years and is still in ministry today and in business. And it's an awesome example of a mother who is teaching her daughter how to make the Easter ham. Now, there's some people that love to cook and I love to eat. So if you love to cook, I'd like to get to know you more because I like to eat. Well, in this instance, this mom was teaching a 7-year-old daughter how to prepare the Easter ham. And of course, the 7-year-old, if you've got 7-year-olds in your life, they're very inquisitive. They like to ask lots of questions. And this mom said, okay, little one, you're gonna watch me. We're gonna learn to prepare the Easter ham. And so the mom got the ham out, and it's this big giant ham, and she got out this big pan. It was this big pan that the big ham was going to go onto. And of course, the little daughter, you know, all of that made sense. And then the mom did something very peculiar. The mom cut off both ends of the ham. And the little girl, 7-year-old, said, Mom, why are you cutting off both ends of the ham? And of course, the mom, you know, if you're any good parent, you know, you make up half of the answers that you give your kids. She didn't know the answer. She didn't really know why we cut off both ends of the ham. And so she said, we better call grandma. Let's call grandma. Grandma will know. It's just part of the recipe. It's written down right here, little one, that we're supposed to cut off both ends of the ham, prepare it, put it in the pan, and then put it in the oven. And so let's call grandma. Well, they called grandma. Grandma kind of beat around the bush. And grandma didn't really know why they cut off both ends of the ham. She just knew that her mom had given her the recipe. And the recipe had said, you have to cut off both ends of the ham before you put it in the oven. So in this family, they had 4 generations. It was Big Mama or Great Grandma that was still alive. How many of you call your great grandmother Big Mama? Well, some do. And so they called Big Mama, great grandmother, and of course she laughed and chuckled, you know, just got a kick out of it. And listening to them as they called, asking, why do we cut both ends of the ham off? And she said, darling, it's because my pan was too small. The pan was too small. I always had to cut both ends of the ham off the end so that I could get it into the pan to then get into the oven. Of course, they all roared laughing. The seven-year-old, like my seven-year-old said, I told you so. There's no reason why you need to be cutting the ham off. Listen, this is a perfect example of limiting beliefs, in many cases, damaging beliefs that we've passed down from one generation to another, that this is the way that we've always done it. Church, I want to impress upon you today as pastor that you need to be diving into God's word. You need to be asking the Holy Spirit about the things, about your belief systems and why you believe certain things that you believe. Even on the topic today, as I'm touching on the Holy Spirit, many people, when I say the words Holy Spirit, they literally cringe and their eyes start to flicker and they get a twitch because I say Holy Spirit. It's because they've been taught in their church upbringing that the Holy Spirit's bad or that he's somehow the awkward uncle that nobody wants to come over. I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit is God himself. Jesus said the Holy Spirit's coming. He's the promise. He's the gift. He's the helper. He's the advocate. Man, I'm preaching good right now. All through the Bible, Jesus is telling us who the Holy Spirit is and then tells the disciples, you got to go into the upper room and you got to wait for the promise to come. Who was that? The Holy Spirit. And so we've got limiting beliefs. We've been doing things in tradition and in ritual year after year that are not in the Bible. That's not in the Bible. And so for us, instead of feeling condemnation, you know, I want you to see Cornelius, who had all kinds of religiosity, and he was very devout, and the Lord heard his prayers, but he was locked in. He needed a word to free him from the words that had bound him. And then Peter had all this religion, even though he had received Jesus as the Messiah, he had all this religion that he couldn't minister to people outside the Jewish nation. But really, God was calling himself, he was calling the disciples to minister to the Gentiles. Well, the Holy Spirit had to break some limiting and damaging beliefs off of Peter, a Jew, and off of Cornelius, a Gentile. Now, mostly everyone listening to me today is a Gentile. We all fit into this story. So I want to tell you that the Holy Spirit has come to remove damaging and limiting beliefs. Today, as I continue, and I'm almost done preaching, I want you to ask the Holy Spirit right now, what is it in me? Do I have some limiting beliefs? Am I limiting God and what he can do in my life? Do I have some paradigms and some rituals and routines and traditions within my life? Maybe that's been passed down in your Christian faith, but they're just not biblical. You need to ask the Holy Spirit to reveal those things to you. Because in the same way that Cornelius was limited and Peter was limited, you can be limited. But God has sent the Holy Spirit, its resurrection power, it's the resurrection promise to break that stuff off of your life. Now let's continue reading. Acts chapter 10 and 34, then Peter opened his mouth and said, in truth, I perceive that God shows no partiality. So now he's getting this revelation and now he's preaching it to him. Verse 35, but in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him. And of course, as he continues to preach, they receive Jesus as the Messiah. They receive the forgiveness of sins, which is the ministry of grace. But Peter says very pointedly, whoever fears him, Proverbs tells us that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The opportunity for you to start down the road of having true, crystal clear revelation and understanding of what God has brought to you starts with whomever reveres the Lord, respects and honors the Lord, that's not flippant about their time in prayer. Hear me now. That doesn't downgrade or move. The first thing that doesn't go off your schedule is your devotion time. Because what he's saying of whoever fears the Lord is 100% submitting themselves to what the Lord has for their life. And listen, if the Lord told you a year ago, I want you to give me son or daughter, I want you to give me 5 minutes in the morning to pray and read the word, there is nothing in this world that should keep you from that 5 minutes of prayer and the word. you're 100% that you fear the Lord, meaning you revere him, you respect and honor him, and that the Lord can do something with that when you fear him. Now, reading on, he says, and works righteousness. Well, what is he saying there? He's just saying pursues righteousness or pursues the right thing or pursues right living. Now, listen, we know in both of these instances, Peter, who's preaching, and Cornelius, who's listening with all of his household, they had things that they needed to get fixed. They had things that they needed to get right. But Peter was saying, look, if you can fear the Lord, and you can pursue righteousness, even if you're, and we see here, even if they're kind of messing up a few things or they have wrong beliefs, God can do something with that. God can do something with that. Ephesians 2 and 10 says that we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works. He's called us to do good works. And of course, James says faith without works is dead. What does that mean, Pastor? That means if you get off the couch, so to speak, of life, and you get up and get moving with God and saying, you know what? I'm going to pursue righteousness. I'm going to pursue righteous living. I'm going to fear the Lord. And along the way, I may miss some things along the way. I may not perceive, I'm helping somebody right now. I may not perceive some things exactly right or precisely the right revelation, but God is going to correct it along the way. The Holy Spirit and the ministry of the Holy Spirit is going to bring that correction. He'll remove those things from your life by highlighting them and you saying, my goodness, why have we always been cutting the ends of the ham off, like a seven-year-old would ask? And that's where the Holy Spirit can bring that revelation to you. And that's exactly what he did for these two, for Peter and for Cornelius and his entire household. Matthew 6 and 33, it's not in your notes. I'm just giving you the address so you can go back and read it. It says this, it says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Isn't that good? And his righteousness, you fear the Lord and you pursue righteousness, or as Peter said here, he said, work righteousness in Matthew 6 and 33, and then all these things will be added unto you. So seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. That should be a relief today that I'm preaching this way to you, that God can do something with a person who fears him and is pursuing righteousness. You with me on that? God helped Cornelius. God helped Peter. He can help you. Now let's end today. Acts chapter 10, verse 44 says this, and while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell. Man, how powerful. And upon all those who heard the word, and those of the circumcision who believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God, hallelujah. Then Peter answered, can anyone forbid water? He's talking about now water baptism. He wanted them to be water baptized, that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. Shouldn't these be baptized just as we have? Verse 48, and he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then they asked him to stay for a few days. Man, they loved what Peter preached, and so they wanted to hear more of what he had to say. And of course, here we see in Acts chapter 10, I wanna draw this out really quick, Acts chapter 10, which is quite a ways in time from Acts chapter 1 and 2, that the Holy Spirit fell. I want you to see this real quick. The Holy Spirit fell in Acts chapter 10 onto the people in Cornelius's home in the same way that the Holy Spirit poured out in Acts chapter 1 and 2. And in verse, I think it's verse 1 of Acts chapter 2, in the fullness of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit was poured out. Now, I bring that up to you because you can continue to read in the New Testament multiple times where the Holy Spirit's been poured out. There's a prevailing belief in mainline Christianity today that the Holy Spirit was only poured out one time on the day of Pentecost. And I'll tell you that that's not in the Bible. That's one of those religious thinkings where you cut off the ends of the ham and it's not actually in the Bible. It's not truth. The Holy Spirit has been poured out on believers every day since Pentecost. What am I telling you? This is a New Testament, New Covenant pattern that God has brought when Jesus ascended into heaven. He poured out the Holy Spirit. This was Joel's prophecy that actually Peter preached. Man, I'm giving you a lot today. That Peter preached in Acts chapter 2 and then Acts chapter 3, where Peter preached. This is the prophecy that of Joel that said, I'm going to pour out my spirit upon all flesh. That's exactly what we see here in Acts chapter 10. We saw it back in Acts 1 and 2, and then you see it throughout the New Testament. So this is a New Testament pattern of the Holy Spirit. Now, in summary, what is the resurrection promise for me? Number one, that we receive spiritual revelation. Two, that the Holy Spirit removes damaging and limiting beliefs. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know today, in the same way that the Holy Spirit was poured out in Acts chapter 2 and in Acts chapter 10, and then you can read again if you want, I think it's Acts 19, where there was disciples that were believers in Jesus, but they did not even know that there was a Holy Spirit. There's many of you listening to me today, you've never been taught these things out of Acts. In fact, the church that you grew up in probably never read the book of Acts or the epistles of Paul throughout the New Testament. Listen, you need to read those. You need to dive into those. You need to see the empowerment of the Holy Spirit and the resurrection promise that's throughout the New Testament, because it's true for us as it was for them. Now today, we're gonna end in worship. The guys are gonna come back and we're gonna worship together. I want you right there. We've been doing this every week. Go ahead and stand right there. Remove the stuff that's around you. Move your Bible and stuff. I want you to go ahead and stand to your feet and we're gonna worship together. I want you to put this stuff that I've taught today before the Lord, right? In the same way, much of what I've given you today is information, but only your spirit can receive the revelation. The natural man, the Bible said, remember? The Bible says the natural man can receive the natural, but it's the spirit man that receives the spirit and it receives spiritual revelation. So today, that's my prayer for you, that the Lord will shine a light onto your life and onto your heart and on your beliefs to say, you know what? Now, I have been limiting God, or I have some damaging beliefs that have been passed down in my family that I'm recognizing now as I'm reading the scriptures that are just not true. Today, I know that God is bringing peace, he's bringing comfort, and more than ever, he's bringing joy that is unspeakable to your home. Laughter is filling the homes of Legacy Chapel. Let's pray today. Father, we thank you for a time we can be together in worship. I thank you, Lord, for what you are doing in us and through us during this season. No virus is going to keep us from worshiping. No circumstance in this world is going to keep us from pressing in to the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Father, I pray today for revelation knowledge, for wisdom, for insight, for understanding. Lord, that you bring revelation to our lives that we need. Lord, in these next few moments as we worship, I pray for those today that recognize in their own life that they probably have had some damaging beliefs and some limitations on God. Father, I pray by your Spirit that you minister life to them. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, let's worship together right now.
I've never known a love like yours. I've never known a love like yours. So Jesus, Jesus, what a Savior, what a brother, what a friend. You're the lifter of the lowly. God, you meet me where I am. Your heart, it knows no
Father, we love you today. We thank you for this amazing and awesome and spirit-filled time together. Lord, in the opening of your word, that you've revealed more truth and more revelation knowledge for our lives that we need. Holy Spirit, we call upon you today. We ask you to come. Come reside in our homes. Come reside in our lives today. Holy Spirit, we can't do it without you. We can't go and be witnesses. We can't go and do what we're called to do. We can't go reach the destiny that you've asked us and called us to without you, Holy Spirit. We need you in our lives today. Father, I thank you that you're speaking to people right now in their homes, right where they're at. I thank you for it in Jesus' name. Now, church, I want to instruct here just for a moment, because as I've read a lot today in these passages of scripture, I want to leave you with a couple of things. Number one, if Jesus is your Lord and Savior, and you have been faithful through the work of the Holy Spirit in your life to Jesus being your Savior and your Lord, you have the ability, just like Peter and Cornelius, to receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And I want to encourage you in this way. As we saw Peter preach to Cornelius, just the simple fact that you fear the Lord and that you work righteousness or you pursue righteousness, today, right there in your home, you can call upon the Holy Spirit. Maybe you've never done that before. I want to tell you with great integrity of scriptures and proper interpretation of those scriptures that the Holy Spirit wants to come. The Holy Spirit wants to be a part of your life. But know this, he's a gentleman. Meaning, if you don't let him in through the door of your heart, he won't come in. But if you say today, in the simplicity of words, in the triteness of words, you can say, Holy Spirit, come, and invite him to come. Cornelius didn't even know that there was a Holy Spirit. Peter didn't even recognize that he had a limiting and damaging belief. But when the Holy Spirit came, he revealed it. And I believe right now in your home that as you cry out to the Lord and you say, Holy Spirit, come, I can't do this thing called life without you. I need the empowerment. I need the anointing that Jesus had, the Christ, that means the anointing, can come into your home right now. So as we end this service today, I want you to just say those simple prayers. It doesn't have to be anything flamboyant or outrageous. You just say, Holy Spirit, come. If you would, you could stand with your hands open, just in a posture of receiving, saying, Holy Spirit, come. I receive you right now, the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And the Lord says that when we call upon him, we shall be saved. We shall receive the promises. We shall receive what he has for us. Jesus' instructions to the disciples were go and wait. Go and receive what it is that I have for you, the promise. So today I want to pray over you and pray over your homes. Father God, we thank you that Jesus came to this earth on assignment to bring us back into right standing. And in the same way, he left his anointing, the Holy Spirit, in this earth, that the Holy Spirit came for the New Testament believer, for the believers in the year 2020. Holy Spirit, I ask you to go quickly to every home and every heart that cries for you. God, we know today you hear our cries, you hear our prayers. We pray today for your empowerment, for your strength, for your wisdom that comes in our life. Now, Father, I pray over the fruits of the Spirit to manifest in our lives and the gifts of the Spirit to manifest in our lives. Father, I thank you today for revelation knowledge. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, today, I love you. I can't wait for us to be back together and worship together. I'll tell you that I'm getting maybe a little too comfortable with preaching to the camera, so I need you to come back quickly. For those that are ready to come back, we're gonna be sending that out to you this week with some instructions. But please, when we end right now, jump over to your email, fill out that survey, give us your feedback, let us know that you're coming. We'd love to hear from you. And listen, we pray for you daily. I love you guys. We'll see you right back here next week. Take care.